Hey guys, in this video I'm going to show you how to make a local development server for Python applications using VirtualBox Vagrant. So I've created a Vagrant box which I'm going to show you how to clone and get up and running so that you can get up and running with a Python, local Python development server in a matter of minutes. So before you get going, you're going to want to install, if you don't have it already, you're going to want to install VirtualBox, and that's at virtualbox.org, and you can download it for Windows, Mac, or PC, so there's no limitations. It's available for all operating systems. So you want to get VirtualBox installed, and then you want to install Vagrant, which again is available for Mac, PC, and Linux, and you want to install Git, which again is available for all your operating systems. So I'll put the links to these sites in the notes in case you don't have them installed already. And they're fairly simple to install. You just go through and you just download it, download the relevant installer for your operating system, and you just follow the instructions on screen. So once that's done, you're good to go, and you can just go over and quite quickly get a Python development server up and running on your local machine. So I've gone ahead and created this project, which I called the video-tutorial-Python-DRF-intro. And this is going to serve as the base project for some future videos that I'm going to do on using the Django REST framework. But this video is simply going to show you how to get up and running with the server, how to clone this to your local machine, and then get it up and running. So all we're going to do is get a local development server going so that you can start building your application. So we'll start by cloning this project. So the first thing you want to do is click on this clone or download, and then choose this link here and copy it. And then go to your local go to your terminal or your command prompt, depending on what operating system you're using. If you're using Windows, you use command prompt. And change to a directory where you want to keep your project files. So I like to keep everything in the workspace directory just to keep all of my code in one place. So change that directory using the cd command, and then type git clone, and then paste the URL of the repository there. Once that's done, you can click hit enter, and then it will pull down all the files for that project onto your local machine. And then you can do cd into the directory, and you see that you've got these files here. Inside this directory, you've got the deploy file and the readme file. So to get up and running with us, to launch our server, we're gonna wanna head into the deploy file, and you wanna type vagrant up and push enter. Now, this can take, if you haven't already got the Ubuntu image installed in your local machine, then it can take 10 to 15 minutes to download the files and to provision the server the first time you run it. So I basically have this running already. So if you're going ahead and doing that now, and it's downloading the files, then maybe you wanna pause the video and go grab a coffee and then come back when it's done. So I'm actually gonna go into the project that I may have already set up. So once you're in the deploy folder, as I said, just type vagrant up. And what vagrant up does is it tells vagrant to run your server. So it will look at the vagrant file, which is in the deploy folder. So I'll just load this directory up in my text editor here, and so I can show you. So that's the other one. Let's have them. Yeah, so load up your open the project files in your favorite text editor. I use Atom. And if you look in the deploy folder, you can see that there's a few files in here. So when you type vagrant up, it looks into this vagrant file and it builds a server to the specification defined in that vagrant file. So because I already have it running, it was very quick. If you don't already have the server running, then it takes a bit longer. But once once vagrant up has completed, you can then type vagrant SSH, And you'll be connected to your local development server. So this is actually a, I'm using Linux as my desktop, but if you're using Windows or anything, then this will be a bit different because this actually loads a separate Linux server up on your host operating system. So this has actually installed the Ubuntu operating system in a virtual machine, and it's given me, it's basically allowed me to connect to that using SSH. So whatever I do on here is completely isolated from my machine. If I break anything inside this box here, then it won't affect my desktop operating system. And that's one of the nice things about using Vagrant, is it gives you like isolation from your development box and your local workstation, so you don't need to worry about, you know, messing up the settings or anything on your local machine. And also it's nice if you're using Windows but you want to install, you want to develop your Python app on in the same environment that you're probably going to deploy it on, which is a Linux server, then it's also nice to be able to run a Linux server inside Windows, and the same for Mac. So now that's up and running, I'll show you, I'll walk you through what's happening with this Vagrant file. So the Vagrant file, as I said, defines what the server is going to, it's basically defines what the server is going to be, or what we want the server to be. So all Vagrant configs are wrapped in this vagrant.configure statement. And inside that, the first thing we define is the box. So this vm.box says we want to run the Ubuntu image, Ubuntu trusty 64 image. It's a popular image. Most people already have it on their machines, so that's why I choose that one. You can see all the available boxes here at this link that's in the comments. So that's the base operating system, or the base box that we're going to build on top of to build our development server. This here is the network. So we're forwarding the port 8000 to our host on port 8000. So that means that when we're developing, if we have a local development server, which we will do in later videos, your local development server will be running on port 8000, and it will allow us to, forwarding the port allows us to access that on our local machine. So we can just do, we don't need to worry about the IP address of the Vagrant box. We can just type localhost port 8000, and it will map that, it will forward that port into our development server, which is a great feature. It makes it a lot easier to manage instead of having to, you know, manage IP addresses of different servers and stuff. You just map it to your localhost and then you're good to go. The next three statements are synced folders. So these are basically synchronizing folders on our server, on our virtual server, to our local operating system. So the first one is slash vagrant. So we go to our server, we go to cd slash vagrant. So remember, this is running in a virtual machine. You can see that it has the readme and deploy files, which are also in our root folder. That's because we've mapped the parent folder deploy to the, we've mapped the deploy, the parent folder deploy to slash vagrant. So whatever goes in here gets put onto our server and vice versa. So we can actually, if we create a new file called HelloWorld.py, and we just do print hello world, which is a standard Python script, and then we go to our server, we type ls, you can see that the files appeared there, so it's mapped there. And if we make one in here, tests.py, and we just say test, you can see that it appears here as well. So the files are synced to and from the server in real time. We can remove the test one for now. Okay, so that's what these three statements do. The first one maps this folder, the second one maps the salt folder, and the third one maps the pillar folder. So the salt and pillar, they're used for the deployment. So we use a salt provisioner. Now saltstack, if you haven't used it before, is a server provisioning tool that allows you to kind of define what you want to be installed on your server in these thing called salt formulas, and then you can use them on multiple servers. So that's how we managed to get a we managed to install the dependencies that we need for developing with very little work, because I've gone ahead and created some salt formula, or a salt formula for Python development, which will install things like Python, Python 3, VirtualEnv, and VirtualEnv wrapper, which are all tools I'll go into more details later. But it basically defines a list of things that need to be set up on that server and configured, and it runs that automatically. So that's what the salt provisioner does. Because the salt provisioner uses Git, I have to do this this manual shell command, which simply just installs Python Git. That's because in salt, I'm using Git, the Git file system, to pull down the salt formulas. But we don't need to go into too much detail about that. Perhaps I'll go into more more details about that in a future video. But I've basically created the script that sets up the server, provisions the server, and installs the dependencies. And down here you have the salt provisioner details. So run high state just means bring it to the highest state in the available formulas. Masterless means that we're just going to run an independent server. It's not going to be connected to a master management server or anything. It's just going to run locally. And the minion config is basically the config file. So we head over to minion here. You can see that there's a few sayings in here. It's basically, this is what I was talking about with the file server backends. We use Git here. And this is my this is the Git, the formula that I created to provision this server. Okay, so that's basically how the Vagrant box works. Now I'll just quickly show you what we have on the server. So the server is set up, and we created our Hello World file. So in my salt formula, I install something called VirtualEnv wrapper, virtual environment wrapper, and that allows us to quickly create virtual environments in for Python. So Python virtual environment is basically, as the name suggests, it's an environment that you can set up on your machine, which can virtualize where the packages are installed. So when you install Python packages that your application needs to run, or the dependencies for your application, if you don't use a virtual environment, then it just installs them on the base operating system, on your kind of base Python install. The problem with that is that if you run multiple Python applications, then you come into conflicts, because some applications require a later version and some require an earlier version of some of the dependencies, and it just gets difficult to manage. So a virtual environment allows us to separate out our dependencies and have it by application. So we can say, like, this application has dependency XYZ, these versions, and it has its own kind of local version and everything, and manages that locally. So the first thing we'll do is we'll type mkvirtualenv, which stands for make virtual env, and we're going to use Python 3. So we'll type hyphen hyphen Python equals Python 3, because Python 3 is the latest version of Python with the most features, and it's going to be the one that's most supported in the long run. But Python 2.7 is still the default on Ubuntu and many other operating systems. So, but we're going to future-proof ourselves, and we're going to use Python 3. So we're going to say mkvirtualenv Python 3 dev. So this, what this is going to do is, let me just rearrange this so you can see it better. Okay, so what this command does is we're saying mkvirtualenv, use Python 3 and make a virtual environment called dev. We push enter. So this will set up a virtual environment and switch to that virtual environment called dev. So here you go, you can see that there's dev in the brackets here. So now that we're in that virtual environment, we can go and install packages and stuff, and we can do things that are relevant to our application. We don't need any packages at the moment because we just ran a simple Hello World app, but I was just showing you this to demonstrate that the server has been set up with everything we need to get going on Python development. So we can just run out hello world app by typing Python hello world. There you go. So that concludes the video. That's how you set up a, or how you get up and running with a local Python development server. Let me know how you get on. If you have any questions at all, then please feel free to leave them in the comments. And thanks a lot for watching. Cheers.